Okay, for the midterm next week, the coverage is going to be the end of today's content, meaning from the second part after midterm one. Yeah. So it's going to be covering until the stability of probability of PAAs. Okay. The same rules. You can bring a handwritten A4 letter size paper. You can write on both sides. And then in addition, you can use your summary sheet for the first midterm you made, prepared for yourself. Okay. And same rules for the starting time, 8 o'clock to 9:30. And let's see, probably three problems. Yeah, probably. Okay? So let's first take a look at what we covered last time. Last time we covered the contents of, we introduced passivity and positive real, strictly positive real, these two new concepts. And then with these two new concepts, we can build the hyperstability theory using this block diagram. This is the main block diagram for this analysis. So we have a linear block, linear feedforward block. And a dynamic nonlinear block. But the main messages are that main properties it has to nonlinear satisfy the Popoff inequality, meaning is a passive. And then this linear time invariant block has to be strictly positive real, SPR. These are the conditions for these two. You can have the hyperstability for this closed loop system. So to begin with the lecture today, I would like to give one example to let you have a feeling of how a hyperstable system in practice looks like. So this is one example of a mass spring damper system. Very important mechanical system and very simple as well. So we have the input, which is a force. And then let's see, the position of the mass is x. So the velocity equals x dot. Okay, then and we can do Newton's law and then analyze the motion, the dynamics of the system. We can have, I won't do too much details here, but we can do, we can obtain the mass times the acceleration plus the damping times the velocity plus the force generated from this spring is going to be equal to the input force. Then we can derive the transfer functions from the input to the output position, which is going to be a second order system. And if we want to obtain the velocity, we just add the derivative on the numerator. So let's do one very general nonlinear design, okay? And I say, put a nonlinear block here. I haven't specified what kind of form, what kind of structure here looks like, but I say the nonlinear block satisfies the Popoff inequality. Okay, this is the only assumption I made for the system. Then let's take a look at how the stability of the system looks like. So if the nonlinear block satisfies Popoff inequality, then you know it very well now. The product for, this is a single input, single output system. So the product between the input of the nonlinear block and the output of the nonlinear block has to be lower bounded. This is Popoff inequality. Now, take a look at this. The input to the nonlinear block is going to be the output of the linear block. And the output of the nonlinear block is going to be the, in this case, the negative of the input to the linear block. So, you know, now, this condition, the Popov inequality condition, simply means we made one intuition last time. What does it simply mean from the power or work perspective? It consumes, it doesn't generate energy, okay? So if you regard, if you replace, now I said W is just the negative of U. So if you do this substitution from W to U, you're going to derive this condition. So now look at this one. It simply means the energy, the work that's supplied to the system, to the linear, now focus on this linear system now. The energy supplied to this linear system is bounded. This simply, this is the meaning for this equation over here. Okay? So because of energy conservation, now suppose the final time is t, suppose the final time is t1, and that t1, the position and the velocity of the system are x and v, and the initial time 0, the position and velocity are x0 and v0. Because of energy conservation, the final energy, right, the energy, these two parts, this is from the spring and this is from the moving mass. These are the energy components in the system. So the final energy minus the initial energy is going to be equal to the energy supplied to the system. The final energy minus the initial energy is going to be the energy supplied to the system. So because of what we just derived, this simply means this supplied, this supply of energy is lower bounded, upper bounded. Now, these are quadratic functions of V and X. So I can easily define some states for the system, X1 and X2. These two quadratic functions becomes the norm, the two norm square of the two state. So just a simple substitution of notations. Then this equation simply means the norm of the state for the system at the final time is going to be upper bounded by something defined by the initial state and by this constant from the Popov inequality. Okay? So this is less than or equal to this. This is directly from this equation here. Then you can do a little bit additional algebra. So you can recognize that these two is going to be upper bounded by these two. So it's very easy to see. Just do the algebra. Okay? So what does this equation looks like to you? This let me rewrite it here. Xt less than or equal to x0 plus gamma 0 square. What does this equation look like to you? Find it. It's here. So let's see. In the definition of hyperstability, we have here. Let me. Okay. So we said a system is hyperstable. This closed loop feedback system is hyperstable if and only if there exist positive constant gamma, a delta and gamma, such that So we're looking at the continuous time system, such that this holds. Okay? So you see, this guy is nothing but, if you take the square root of this, is nothing but a special case for this inequality. So now you see, after analyzing, after doing this example, you see now what hyperstability really means. Okay, it just means in this system how the energy is consumed and how these two conditions in the nonlinear block and in the linear block is played. As an exercise, take a look at this transfer function, this linear system here. This LTI block, take a look at whether it's SPR or not. So as a quick summary, we have mentioned this. This is essentially the message I just talked about, intuition here. So satisfying Popov inequality means a bounded supply. Apply to the system. And then because of energy conservation, the total energy of this LTI block is going to be bounded. Okay. So if the energy of this guy is bounded and it's SPR, which means it's going to consume energy, then the state will be bounded. If in addition, I mentioned this part. So if it consumes energy, then the bounded supply will eventually be all consumed. So hence the stability of the system. This is from the example we talked about. So hyperstability is a new concept to many of you. I want to make a remark. It connects to general stability you have seen in the pure system analysis earlier. So take a look at these two examples. Let's start with the first one. If the in the conventional sense, this should be relatively easy to see. It is stable, right? What is minus k minus 1 sounds, yeah, I think you're right. Okay, so this is negative. The pole is negative, so it's a stable pole. Now, look at this guy. Is this not, is this block passive or not? It is passive. We talked about this example last time. We talked about this even more complicated example that if the feedback lies in a sector bound in this range, then it's going to be non, it's going to be passive, satisfying the Popov inequality. So this is actually passive. And then what about this one? Is this SPR or not? So what do you need to do to verify whether it's SPR or not? First of all, is it stable or not? It's stable. So satisfying the first condition. The second condition, the real part of the frequency response has to be on the right-hand side of the imaginary axis. So if you take a look, substitute S equal to J omega here, and then evaluate the real part, this should be relatively to do. So you're going to see this is SPR. So because the feed forward block is SPR and the feedback block is passive, then this whole system is hyperstable, asymptotically hyperstable. So this you can verify. And we have also seen that in the common sense, which you learned from the perspective of poles of the system, this system is also stable. Okay? So Now, however, be very careful. Hyperstable, this is the main message here for the second part of the slide. Hyperstable systems. Stable systems may not be hyperstable. So hyperstable systems, let me rephrase. Hyperstable systems are stable from this example here. However, stable systems may not be hyperstable. This is the second example here. So take a look at again, the port is gonna be, you can verify, it's gonna be probably negative k plus one. And if larger than one, oh, you can verify. So it's stable. It's still. Is this guy positive, strictly positive real or not? When S is less than one, then what? Yeah, that is true. So you can verify, we said, when real part of S is positive, then the real part of this guy has to be positive as well. But you can take a look at if S is, let's say, 0.5, then this guy becomes negative. So it's not SPR. Another way to see is this transfer function is not even stable. So it's impossible for it to be SPR. Okay? So this system is not hyperstable, but it is stable. Hyperstability is a stronger requirement than general stability. So now, learning this hyperstability theory is to prove the stability of parameter adaptation algorithm, central goals. And have seen the analysis. I hope you can see the intuition or the ideas behind this. I call it a cookbook procedure. So to analyze PAA stability. From here, it says, first of all, construct something that looks like this. If you want to do PAA stability analysis using hyperstability theory. Construct equations into this block diagram where you have a feedback combination of a linear time invariant block and the nonlinear block. Okay, and then verify these two are verifying the properties of each block here. For the nonlinear block, satisfying the Popov inequality, and the linear time invariant block satisfy the SPR condition. Okay, so these are the standard procedures for PAA stability analysis. Then the final step, when you evaluate the final step to show that you have to do this additional step, the output of the feedback block, so let's say VW. Okay? The final step is to show these two signals are bounded. This is because the first step. I hope it is now. The final step is to show this. So if you revisit the asymptotic hyperstability definition, you have this asymptotic hyperstable if and only if, first of all, it's hyperstable. This condition can be easily obtained from the first three steps we just talked about. And then here, be a little bit careful about the final statement here. For all bounded W, satisfying the purpose. We were required to have a bounded signal here for this convergence to hold. So here, that is why we were required to be a little bit careful about the bounded. In practice, usually we look at the first three steps, and the final step, this step four, is usually satisfied. And from time to time, you don't need to do this last step. Okay, so let's see how this analysis procedure carries out. I'm going to use one example of I'm doing recursive least squares analysis. Well, you can recall we have the parameter adaptation loss, a priori adaptation parameter adaptation loss, theta hat k, and then theta hat k plus one, the relationship between them. Okay, we're going to be using, for simplicity, we're going to be using the example where I have a constant adaptation gain, fk equals a constant. So the main conclusion we're going to be arriving at is this PAA is always asymptotically hyperstable, which is a strong condition, which is actually a nice condition. Okay, this is our goal for the several slides that follow in this. Okay. A posteriori parameter adaptation gains is going to be useful for stability analysis. Okay, so actually we derived how from here we can go to here. So in this a posteriori adaptation parameter adaptation as the main starting point, the procedures looks like follows. This is actually pretty standard and works for other kind of PAAs we're going to be. Start from the a posteriori adaptation law, then focus on the arrows. It's like doing observer stability analysis. Focus on suppose the true parameter is theta. Okay, so the definition is theta tilde equals theta hat minus theta. Okay, then you can easily obtain from here to here. Just subtract theta on both sides. You can arrive this equation. This is the parameter estimation error equation, update equation. Okay. Then, with this, the prediction error, a posteriori prediction error, defined by the error between the actual output and the estimated output. Regressive model of the system. So this minus this, because of the notations we have introduced, we're going to have theta minus theta hat times phi. So theta minus theta hat is nothing but negative of, okay, so theta minus theta hat is negative of theta tilde. So we can arrive at this. This equation here. So with this, let me call it star. And then with this guy, with the estimation error equation, let me call it let me write it instead. So look at these two equations. And then see if I regard now I'm going to draw the construct the feedback block. This feedback connection. Out. You see, because of this, we're going to have, what's the transfer function of the linear block? That's the output, and this is the input. Then the equation star is going to give us, identity. Is this SPR or not, by the way? It's definitely SPR because, no matter how you evaluate this, it's SPR. So now I have this. And then what about the nonlinear block? Actually, now I can move this one and focus on here. So for the nonlinear block, we have to figure out somehow what's the connection between theta tilde times phi and then epsilon. So you can see here, actually, we can get this from this equation. So we are going to have epsilon, first of all, multiplies. I'm going to use this notation. This is multiply. Just kidding. Let me redraw this. It's a bad drawing. Just to make it more clear. Now we have a definitely SPR linear time invariant block. Now I would like to see how this nonlinear block can be constructed. So now you see, look at this. This error signal, first of all, is multiplied by phi of k. So I'm going to use this notation as multiplication. Okay? And then, this gain block. Finally, I want to this signal here. So you see, F then going through. Now this signal would be, let me look at this signal, it's going to be F phi epsilon k plus 1. So with this, how will I be able to write this equation in a block diagram? I'm going to it's on this side actually. One here. So it's actually exactly exactly a first order dynamics. You look at this, it's a first order dynamics. I'm gonna have theta tilde k plus 1 equals theta tilde k. So this is theta tilde k plus 1. This is gonna be theta tilde k. This now we have theta tilde multiplied by we're going to obtain this this signal here, theta tilde. We have constructed theta tilde transpose times phi. So this whole thing, on the is the nonlinear block. Okay, so let me ask you a question that can be tricky or may not be tricky. Why is it nonlinear? I said these are nonlinear block. Why? So now we have constructed this. Let me use this picture. So probably easier to see. Because of the delay, how is this delay constructing the nonlinearity? So let's first think about what is the output of this block. And what is the dynamics between the what's the dynamic equation between the output and input? It's not on this page. You have to write it out yourself. So starting from here, can someone derive the relationship between the output and the input? Starting from here. So create, I think you need to multiply phi to both sides of the equation here to get it. A moment to derive it. Let me know if any of you has found it. Say that again. Very careful. I already do it's a nonlinear system. There's no transfer function. Non-linear system doesn't have transfer functions. Yeah. It's just a general. Probably it should have been mentioned in 232 or some introductory course. Non-linear system doesn't have a transfer function. That's why we always use different equations or differential equations for non-linear systems. Is anyone? I wanted to ask the equation between them. It's actually this question itself is not tricky. I just want to know what's the equation, what's the relationship between them. It can be easily derived from here. I think you are correct in the sense, I think you already found the relationship. It's just you said it in a transfer function way. But let's see. What would be, some of you must have derived it. What's the answer you've got? If I write this, what is the relationship? Some function of epsilon, what is it here? It's gonna be theta tilde the transpose times phi, right? And then what's the next part? So you take the transpose of this equation on both sides and then multiply phi on the right hand side. Then if F is symmetric, I'm gonna have. Did anyone get anything that looks like this? So if I take the transpose, now it all remains to be done is take the transpose of this and multiply by phi on the right hand side. So the transpose of this guy, if I regard this as a, take the transpose, then you're gonna have epsilon on the left hand side originally, but epsilon is a scalar, so it doesn't matter where I put it. So I'm gonna have phi transpose k transpose of f, and I said if f is symmetric, then f transpose equals f. Okay, and then multiply phi on the right hand side, you're gonna get. So now you see, the left-hand side is a function, let me say, f of theta tilde and phi. Okay. So this should be no question. The left-hand side is a function of theta tilde and phi, right? The right-hand side is a function here. I'm going to use g in this case. G theta tilde k. Let me put the index here. K plus 1. Phi epsilon. Okay. Now, is this equation linear with respect to phi and epsilon? Consider these two as the variables. Is this linear with respect to, no, it's right, because you have the product term in between this. So, and you see, on the right, on the function, the output is indeed some function of this. So your output depends on phi, which comes in, kicks in as a nonlinear element in the dynamics, right? So you see, it's not linear. The input-output relationship is not linear. That's why. Because your output here depends nonlinearly on input. Your output depends on phi. If phi is non-linear, when you have phi is non-linear has a non-linear relationship between. Yes. Which page? This. The relationship, yeah. This is for considering the this part. So I said. Be careful. Be careful. For this example, we have identity here, but in general, this is not identity. So there's going to be dynamics inside. Yes. Yes. So be careful. I did the analysis just now, simply trying to see whether I simply was testing whether this is nonlinear or not. I wasn't really saying anything else. I just wanted to test whether this is linear or nonlinear. Nothing else. Don't overthink it. The relationship let me see. Think about it in this sense. Here. For this one, we are deriving, this is the dynamics, right? Theta hat, theta tilde k plus 1, theta tilde k. This is the dynamics. And this here is just the direct input-output relationship. Here, our focus is on seeing the dynamics of theta tilde and epsilon. Here, it just turns out, I say again, it turns out it's one here. Actually, it can be more complicated. It's like, let me see if I can give you something. Even for the previous example, let me bring it up. Which to zero? Here? Yeah, you're saying if it's non-zero, let's say some values of reference. Yeah, that is also another way. I wanted to, I will come back to this. Well. Let me come back to here, even. This is at the beginning of the class. So if you think of this way, then it's senseless whether this nonlinear block looks like. Because you can always take a look at only just the input and output of the linear block. Then we're always going to have a linear relationship, right? Then this doesn't matter, it sounds like. But it's not the case, right? When we do stability analysis, we have to think about the both blocks. Another point, your classmate mentioned this. When we are doing stability analysis, actually, it doesn't matter whether it's zero or non-zero. When considering stability, it just it only concerns these two blocks. It doesn't matter whether the reference is zero or not. But if the reference is non-zero, then you won't have the relationship the here. You won't have this anymore, right? Yeah, that's another way. Look at it. Okay? So we have derived linear block and nonlinear block. Now, this is step one, transforming the system to a feedback structure. For the step two, is the Popov inequality. I still need this. It's the Popov inequality of this block here. So again, I think the main step here is to really recognize what is the input and output of the nonlinear block. Now you have seen the input is epsilon, the output is theta tilde transpose times phi. Right? So verify, if you want to do Popov inequality analysis, we have to consider the summation of their product. And I have to find, we have to find the lower bound for this summation here. Okay? So the next few slides is going to be explaining that this equation indeed holds. It's going to be involve a little bit of algebra, so I think I will derive it. I will derive it once. Then this technique can be used. It's very common for the remaining analysis we're going to do in the course. Okay, so I want to focus on this guy. So the summation for the Popov inequality is going to be this epsilon k plus 1. Okay, so remember first the dynamics of the parameter estimation error. Then we are one, theta tilde transpose k plus 1. Then this guy, it can be obtained from here. Multiply F inverse on both sides. We are going to get F inverse theta tilde k plus 1 minus theta tilde k. Okay? It should have some hope, I should say. You should believe when we have quadratic functions, then it's possible to find the lower bound. It turns out it is. So let's write it out first. And then k plus 1 f inverse theta tilde k plus 1 minus theta tilde transpose k plus 1 f inverse theta tilde k. Okay? So you see, it has a quadratic function of theta tilde k plus 1. And then there is a cross product function between theta tilde k and theta tilde k plus 1. So can someone give me a suggestion? If I want to construct some kind of squared terms, what should I add to this equation here? So you see my logic? I have some quadratic function already about theta tilde k plus 1. But here, this guy is not a quadratic function. It's cross product between theta tilde k plus 1 and theta tilde k. And I want to make something that's a square term. Something about theta tilde k, right? Exactly. So I want to add something about theta tilde k such that I can make, so this is the general goal. Let me put it here. I want to make something that's going to give me some kind of quadratic function. Maybe it should be F inverse or something. Then this is a okay, so if I'm gonna do this, then I will be able to introduce this cross product term. And this guy is, you see, as you see, it's lower bounded for sure, right? So let's see. I should be adding 0, k1. I'm going to add something that's related to this. And let me just sense. So this is the final result. I'm going to add so the first part is doesn't change. It's this guy. I'm just writing it in another way. And the second part is this. This is the same. Then I'm adding and subtracting. Adding and subtracting. Let me see. I think theta tilde transpose k, F inverse theta tilde k. Okay? So I'm going to do this. That. Okay, I want some quadratic function of this guy. So let's construct it. It's going to be theta tilde k plus 1 minus theta tilde k times F inverse. Okay, this is the first part. So let's see. So I'm writing the result first, and we're going to see together how it looks like. So this guy, I claim, is going to be coming out of. Can someone borrow me, lend me a red pen? Okay, so do the algebra. You see, I have a factor of 1 divided by 2 first is here. And then here, I'm going to have a quadratic term of theta tilde k plus 1, which is here. So this guy, product with this guy, is going to be generating this guy. And then I am going to have a cross product term between theta tilde k plus 1 and theta tilde k. So let me take a moment to write it down. Okay, so if you do that, you're going to get 1 divided by 2. First of all, theta tilde k plus 1 transpose F inverse for the product term. We're going to have this is a minus sign. 1 divided by 2. So if you do this product, multiply out, we're going to have a theta tilde k transpose times F inverse, and then theta tilde k, right? So we're going to have these two terms. And because theta scalar, this is a, I can take the, it still be itself. So you see, these two add up together, it's going to give me this guy, right? And then the final term is going to be the additional term about theta tilde k. So this is the term coming out of this guy. Okay, so it's from here. That's why we have to. So. Term of theta tilde transpose k, one term about this. And then if we add and subtract this guy, so you see we have another half of it lying here, right? Then we have minus theta tilde transpose k, F inverse theta tilde k. Okay? These are these terms. This red. This is the first term. Okay? So this is the result. Anyone has questions for this part? Okay, so let's see how this guy looks like. Then look at these guys. Look at these guys now. What they look like. Commission is here. Extracting. You see? And then I think I'm done. You see? Half of it minus a whole of it. I'm gonna get negative 1/2, which is here. And then this is the remaining part. So now it becomes, let's see, this, I think this is my final result. So let me write it again. Let's see what it's like. It looks like summation from 0 to k1. First of all, this guy, I don't even need to write it down. Something positive. And then for the remaining part, it's going to be 1 divided by 2. Theta tilde k plus 1 transpose F inverse theta tilde k plus 1 minus theta tilde k F inverse theta tilde k transpose. Forget about this term first. It's always positive, so it's lower bounded. What is the summation of this guy? If you sum it up, what is it? Final time is k1. Initial time is zero. So let's work on this. So write it out. Summation from 0 to k1. You're going to have, when it's 0, it's negative 1 divided by 1 divided by 2. Theta tilde 1 transpose F inverse theta tilde 1 minus theta tilde 0 transpose F inverse theta tilde 0. What happens if k becomes 1? It's going to be plus theta tilde transpose 2. Oops. Theta tilde 2. What is the minus here? 1. Okay, you see, this guy cancels with this. And similarly, this will cancel with whatever that follows here. So in the end, what is the final form? B. K1 plus 1 transpose. This is the final time when k equals k1. You see? Minus the initial, we're going to have, you see, this guy is always not canceled. This is always positive, non-negative. So now you see, so this guy is lower bounded. This guy, summation of this guy is lower bounded. And we already see this guy is also lower bounded. So in the end, the final result is that we have now derived this inner product between the input and output is going to be lower bounded by this. It's going to be lower bounded by this term. Okay? And now you should be able to see why, when we talk about the pop-off in side, is exactly this. Okay? So any questions for this part? This is usually the part, this is usually the part that requires a little bit of writing. But now on, if you can translate the PAA into this structure, if you can translate the nonlinear block into this structure, then you don't need to prove it. You can say, in the class, we derived this as pop of inequality satisfied. So, so now we have seen the pop of inequality, and then I think the we're actually done. Shown this is passive satisfying pop of inequality, and this is strictly positive real. So from these conditions, we can here, we know now that the adaptation system is asymptotically hyperstable. Okay? So I mentioned that we have the boundedness of the signals. So we need to see whether these are bounded or not. It actually is not very difficult to see. So we want to see whether this is bounded. So it's equivalent to see whether this is bounded. Is this bounded or not? So from hyperstability analysis, if the system is hyperstable, then the state is going to be bounded for sure. So this is bounded. So this will be bounded. So yeah. W, I think I'm writing it here. W is bounded. W is bounded. So we can say the whole thing is the state of this block is essentially the epsilon. So this guy will converge to zero. Okay, from hyperstability analysis. Okay. So this completes the proof of showing and analyzing hyperstability of the parameter adaptation algorithm. And you see, it's indeed. So the main message from the last few slides is that recursive least squares, PAA recursive using recursive least squares is asymptotically hyperstable. So it's a nice property. Now I want to give you a different perspective, a different way of understanding this. So it's actually not very difficult to see why this epsilon is going to converge to zero. Because if this pop-off inequality between input and output is lower bounded, so which is saying because W here, W equals, for this particular case, W equals negative of epsilon k plus 1. Okay? So this guy okay, if pop-off inequality is satisfied, W is equals to epsilon square, then the negative sign here is going to be, it's going to give us the, it's going to reverse the sign of this inequality here. So this is the message implied over here. Looking at this, then epsilon has to must converge to zero. Otherwise, if epsilon doesn't converge to zero, this summation here is never going to be upper bounded. If it's epsilon is something that looks like this, it keeps on going. Summation is That's the intuitive way to understand why epsilon has to go to zero. So now we have finished the proof. I want to make another remark, is that recall the relationship between a posteriori estimation error and the a priori estimation error. So they're satisfied by this condition. Now we have shown that this goes to zero. Okay, so the definition of these two are epsilon zero, epsilon naught is yk plus one, minus y hat zero k plus one. Be careful, this converging to zero, this converges to zero, why? If this guy goes unbounded, go to infinity, it will make this go to zero, right? So the only thing remaining is that be careful. And if you really want to see, you have to show that phi is bounded, which is usually the case, by the way. But for rigorous, I won't be talking too much. In this class, usually phi will be bounded. And unless I specifically ask you in the exam, show that this is bounded. You don't need to show that. Okay? So this is usually indeed bounded. That's the main message here. So finally, you already seen this. This is only a special case. In practice, there were in your block. Can have variations, but the analysis, the steps that we'll be following will be the same. Okay, so yeah, the time seen hyperstability theory, and we have analyzed PAA stability using hyperstability theory. Okay, so the remaining parts, I mentioned one. Point last time. I said SPR, being SPR, implies strictly passivity. Okay, I didn't show you why, but if you want to know, I can do that on the board today. Okay, I have one exercise. I will give you the hint, and I don't. We won't take the time to fully solve this problem. So the problem looks like the following. Analyze, so edge, I have a construction of several block diagrams where edge is a nonlinear block satisfying this. So this essentially is saying if this is x and this is edge, then edge of x is going to be in this sector bound. This is the slope is 2, the slope is 5 here. This is the dynamics of edge. And then I have several other terms here. One is here, AS plus 1, well, A is positive. And then I have an integrator here. Then I'm asking, are these four block diagrams, which one of them satisfies the Popov inequality and which one doesn't satisfy? Okay. This is an exercise. So what would be your strategy to analyze this? Let's talk about strategy. If you want to show whether this satisfies the Popov inequality, what would you do? There are probably at least two ways to do this. One way is more based on definition, and another way is using properties of passive systems. Just tell me any thoughts you have. What would be one obvious way that you can try is to do, let me see, I'm doing the continuous time case. So, is to analyze the inner product, the integration of inner product. Analyze this, whether it's lower bounded by something. That's one way to do. Okay, what would be another way? Another way would be using properties of passive systems. So we analyzed, if S1 and S2 are both passive, then this is passive. Or this connection is also passive. So look at this. Then one way to show is this is passive and this is passive. Okay, so that's one hint for you. Okay, so you can do similar strategies for the other parts. Okay, like an exercise. Try this. Okay, so for the remaining several minutes, I think a quick overview of this lemma, and then I can of course prove it. For the detailed algebra if you want me to. So otherwise, I will just talk about the general concepts here. So it turns out there is someone very good, several people very good at math figured this out. The condition is saying if you want to analyze the strictly positive realness of a transfer function, which is has this state space realization A, B, C, D over here, satisfying this basic controllability, observability conditions. Then it's saying that strictly positive real, if and only if these three matrix inequalities be very careful. Now we only have these three equations. We have no anything like omega verifying G of J omega here. So if you recall, strictly positive realness, we have to analyze the real part of the frequency response at any frequency, right? For any omega. Now, this lemma is saying, no, you don't need to do that. You just need to take a look at whether this can be satisfied. So it's connecting this frequency domain, strictly positive realness, with some time domain equation. That's all about this equation, this lemma here. This is for linear system, yeah, exactly. So this is for continuous time system. There's an equivalent version for discrete time systems where this equations looks a little bit different, but it's still a bunch of matrix equations. Okay, so now in that it will be very easy to verify the claim I made during the lecture last time. So the claim is that if the system is positive real, then it's going to be passive. And if it's strictly using that lemma, we can do that. Because now we will be able to, the big idea is like this. So using the lemma, so let me see, strictly positive real, using the, it's called KYP lemma, Kamen Yagamuchi Popov lemma. Using this lemma, we can obtain a bunch of matrix equalities. which can give us passivity. Because the whole thing about passivity, if for, let's say, for linear system, for a continuous system, is all about the inner product between the input and output. Let me use V, U and Y. Okay? Using this matrix equation, this, we will be able to show this is indeed lower bounded. Okay, so that's the main message, main strategies. I don't have time now, I see. So it looks like how the actual inequality is constructed. So I'll just go to, yeah. This proof is not required, so take as much as you can. But it won't occur in the exam. So in the end, this is what you can get. This guy, this input and output inner product, is going to be, if you add this up, it's going to be lower bounded by this some term that's positive. And if you shift these terms, these are all positive terms, you can get some lower bound. That's the main derivation steps here. Okay? So after finishing this, we should have a solid, we should have a very well formulated logic for everything here. So take a moment to see how this is integrating to why everything now makes sense. And come to me any questions. Right? So don't forget to turn in your proposal here, and then that will be this lecture.